This video will be a basic introduction for physical constraints. First, their setup process. Most of the constraints work with two attachments, however these don't need to be on some parts. A lot of the constraints I will use on this video will be on parts just for simplicity. I used a hinge constraint for this part. Constraints activate when the game is running, so I will need to run to see how it works. Every single constraint will be shown later in the video, however I will first demonstrate some of the similar properties of all of them. You can create these constraints visually from this Create button and Model tab. To see the constraints details, you need to go to Model tab and find these three buttons in Constraints section. By default, it's like this. However, you can enable them to draw on top of the objects, show constraints details and welds. Showing welds look like this. When you enable constraint details, you can see some warnings. These warnings are important, and you should definitely fix the issues it tells. You can hold the Alt key on this line to see more information about it. After you've done it, you'll see more information about the warning and the constraint. Typically, these warnings are about orientation or position of these attachments. Most of the constraints are rotatable from their origin attachments. You can rotate or move these attachments, just like you are doing it on a part. When you rotate the attachment, you will see that the indicator on it also rotates. This changes the functionality of the constraint, usually changes the constraint's operation axis. When I run the game, you can see that this wasn't like how it was when it wasn't rotated. If you are careful enough, you'll see that parts connected on the position it was pointing to. Some of the constraints have an actuator type property. This allows us to control the behavior manually with a servo or a motor. The main difference between these is, servo works with a target angle and doesn't provide continuous movement. However, motors provide a continuous movement. When you are using these, you should usually disable collisions between these two parts with collision groups or they'll fly. With the basics sorted out, we can move to the types of mechanic constraints. First one is weld constraint. Welds have three variations and this one is the most easy to use. You just need to add a weld constraint and set two properties of it. It will automatically adjust C-frames. However, there's something to know about this constraint. If you move the part which you set as part 0, the constraint will break. When you are scripting this part, you need to make sure that you move it with C-frame and not position. When you move it with position property, connection C-frames do not get recalculated. Right now, I'm moving it with its C-frame, and as you can see, the weld doesn't break. When I move it with its position, you can see that constraint does not update. Next one is weld. This one is not a weld constraint, it's just a classic weld. The difference of this is you need to set the C-frame values just like how an attachment works. This is considered as legacy right now, since there are better alternatives like next one I will show. When I change these C-frame values, as you can see, the connection rotates. Position of these are also changeable. Next one is rigid constraint. This is the last constraint which works like welds. This one is like other ones, however it uses attachments to position the connection. This one doesn't have any problems with moving as well, since it uses attachments. However, the attachment 0 and 1 matters. You can only move the two parts with one of the attachments. The other one is for positioning. Next one is ball socket constraint. As you can see from here, these connections can be moved. The connection of both of the surfaces are calculated with these positions. If you've seen real life implementations of these constraints, they work just like them. This is mostly useful for things like ragdolls, but it has a lot of different uses. Like most of the other constraints, you can set a limit to this constraint. Next one is hinge constraint. You have already seen some of it in beginning of the video. This connects two surfaces together. With hinge constraints, you should make sure that two of these attachments line up well, and also their rotation axis is the same. You should also use commands to line up these, because it's pretty hard to do manually if you don't use snap to grid. These collide with each other so there are no gaps in between these. I will make them non-collidable some moments later, so I can show the motor. After that's done, I can change the actuator type to motor from hinge properties. There are some more properties for motor. These require some physics knowledge. If you don't know what they mean, you can experiment with their movement. If you want to rotate a part like this, hinges are the best way of it. You can also use servos to stop the part on a specific angle. Next one is prismatic constraint. This one allows the part to move in a specific axis without rotation changes. You can see the target axis from constraint details, and you can also rotate it for different axis. In this example, the part will move slowly because of friction. When you are designing a game with this, you should also take that in mind, and maybe not use it on a part or disable the friction. In this specific example, I use limits to not let the part off the platform, but by default, it doesn't have a limit. You can also use a motor to move this part. This is mostly useful for things like elevators. Next one is cylindrical constraint. This works similar to prismatic constraint, however this also allows rotation in one axis. This axis can be rotated like all other constraints. Since this is similar to the other one, I will quickly move to demonstration. When I tilt this, like the other one, this can slide, however it can also rotate in one axis. Next one is universal constraint. This keeps the two parts always perpendicular to each other, and it's mostly used in vehicle rotation transmissions. Both of the attachments can be rotated, and these do matter when they are in operation. They define the part's new rotation axis. As you can see, when I'm rotating the attachment, the red arrow also rotates. This shows what the rotation transmission will be like. When I rotate this green part, the red part will also rotate with it, following the direction of the arrow we saw. Next one is plane constraint. This one is really simple. You need to align two of the planes shown, and the part below will share the same plane with the one above. Since the above one is anchored, it might look like only one of them is getting affected. When I move this part, you can see how this works. Next one is rope constraint. This one isn't surprising. It's just a rope with adjustable physics. Outside of decorations, this rope constraint has a very good but specific use. If you want to make a custom winch system with physics, ropes can be a good solution. If you don't have the time or the knowledge for controlling the physics parameters, or if you just like the default behavior, this constraint also has a separate winch mode. With this mode, you can control the length with the given extra parameters. Next one is the spring constraint. This is also self-explanatory. It's a spring with controllable physics. This is great for things like car suspensions, but has many more uses. The last constraint and this one are very simple to set up. You just need to set up two attachments. They don't need to be on a part to work. You can change the length of the spring, and also change how stiff the spring is. There are some other parameters which you should experiment with. Next one is torsion spring constraint. This is mostly used as an angular spring, if it makes sense. In this example, I have the attachments away from the green part, which doesn't matter, since we are controlling red part anyways. The arrow shows its direction of spring behavior. You can imagine this like a swinging door. By moving the attachments, you can change this target angle of spring behavior. This is not hinged, so it will not create the best example. However, when I rotate this door, you can see how it's supposed to work. These are the basics of current mechanical constraints. There are a lot to build with them, and also experiment when different constraints are used together. That was it for this video. Hope you understood. See you in another one.